Welcome everyone to our Zoom church service. I'm Chipper Ashley, I'm on the church council, and I have a couple of announcements this morning. The first is actually quite an exciting announcement that the search committee hunting for a pastor to replace Mary Brownlow has finished the first draft of the profile that we have to complete and send out before we are allowed to interview applicants. We've put it out from the church office via email, and there are hard copies in a box at the back of the church. We have a couple of sessions scheduled for feedback. Look at the email that you got or call the church office. They'd be Wednesday evening and Thursday morning, and we're hoping to get your input, your suggestions, your criticisms, your edits. We mostly want to know if our profile, actually you recognize our church in our profile, and it's a good picture of who we think we are. The second announcement is that this service is a test, and starting next 2 weeks from now, we're hoping to invite a few members of the congregation to sit in on the service. We'll do the social distance thing, and we're getting ready to prepare for with wipes and hand sanitizer and other kinds of protective policies. So please pay attention to church emails, because we'll give you that information as we approach the 19th. Is that right? The 18th, sorry. And the last announcement is, if you want to stay in the service after it's over, we will unmute your microphones and turn on your videos, and we can enjoy a coffee hour interaction with everyone at home. So like I said, just stay tuned after we'll disconnect this camera, and then we will allow you all to talk to each other. Welcome and thank you.
Please join me in the call to worship. Oh, I can take my mask off. Come and open yourself to the word of God.
We are ready to listen.
Clear your mind so that you may receive.
We are ready to receive.
Engage with your world so that you may find wisdom.
We are ready to engage.
Come to us, Lord, so that we may understand.
O great teacher, we gather with you today to be nourished, not for our bodies, but for our hearts and our minds. We ask that you come to us as we are still and as we are silent, and lead us to knowledge, to wisdom, to understanding, and to transformation. We ask for courage to accept the things that we know to be true, however inconvenient they may be. We ask for your understanding when we struggle to understand, when we place obstacles in the way of our thinking and even our seeing. When we deny what we know, we must ultimately accept. Help us to be active healers in the world, taking your wisdom and guidance and building with it a better world for all of us. And now would you please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Christ.
first scripture reading today is found in the book of Isaiah, chapter 30, verse 15. For thus saith the Lord Jehovah, the Holy One of Israel, in returning and rest shall ye be saved, in quietness and confidence shall be your strength. But he would not. The second scripture reading comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. Come to me, all ye who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and yet shall find rest in your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden light. Here ends the scripture reading. May God bless this to our hearing.
I'm just back from summer vacation in the year of COVID. Having canceled plans first for New York and Broadway and later Florida and some time by the ocean, in the end we spent 8 days, an hour and a half away from here, at Stowe in northern Vermont. We went there with most of our pod. Apparently, according to the New York Times, it is impolite to discuss your pod because they are by nature exclusive and so potentially off-putting. Why don't you ask me to be in your pod, goes the thinking. I choose not to think of it that way, though. I choose to think of it as a precious bit of inclusion. Yes, of course, we are lucky enough to be able to think of many people that we wish we could see and spend time with, that we are separated with now. The fact that we have a small group with whom we are able to do these things doesn't take away from our missing the others with whom we can't. But we cherish the fact that we are no longer just us, that we are able to include again. We have deeply missed including and being included. One of the many things that have been lost during this strangest of seasons. As disorienting as these past months have been, one of the biggest changes for our family has been the slowing of time. Since early June, with Jen's encouragement, and especially while we were away this past week, I've spent much time walking, sometimes with Jen, sometimes with our dog, Balefire, sometimes by myself. By the tyrannical count of my iPhone step counter, by which I now seem to measure my entire physical worth, I walked about 140 miles in June. At my average pace, that was about 45 hours, just walking. What a gift that was. The privilege of reflection. Aside from the time made available to us by COVID, this is a ripe time for reflection. We've been faced with so many stark examples of neglect, oppression, even torture and murder in our streets, that we have been forced to reckon with the evils that surround us. No, that inhabit us. Forced to recognize them for what they are and for how pervasive they remain, no matter how easy it may be for us to forget about them most of the time. Children held in concentration camps on our borders, in our name. Black men tortured and killed in our streets, in our name. Poor families suffering the effects of environmental degradation that others of us believe to be risks of the future. These demand our attention. They call us to answer. And yet, too often, we have no answers. We have no answers, at least in part, because we spend no time considering the questions. Our world suffers many poverties right now. Material poverty, of course. Poverty of compassion. Poverty of imagination, and a poverty of reflection. Back not very long ago, walking was not so much a leisure activity as a primary mode of transportation. Travel was slow, whether by foot, horse, or ship. In any such case, travel provided a great deal of downtime, time that, if one were to choose, would be well suited to contemplation and reflection. That time is mostly past now. Travel now tends to be fast, if it happens at all. Even a quiet vacation, perhaps at a beach resort, is scheduled with everything from snorkeling to mini golf to karaoke night. I typically welcome work after a vacation so that I can finally get some rest. But this year's vacation was different. Most things we would usually do during the day were closed, so we mostly stayed at the house we rented. Perfect for kids during COVID, with room to spread out, and tons of games, a pool table, darts, ping pong. Because we were with our pod, the kids always had other kids to play with, and they did. Having late nights of games and movies, coupled with nothing structured to do, the kids slept late in the morning. But my body kept waking me up at 7 a.m. It seems I barely remember how to sleep in anymore. So I did some work for an hour or so, had my coffee, and then I headed out for a walk. Walking is not the greatest exercise. It doesn't burn calories like running or cycling or swimming. But you don't have to focus on walking either. This can be a hazard. Thales of Miletus, one of our earliest known Western scientists and philosophers, allegedly fell into a well and died while walking and observing the heavens at night. But in general, walking moves at the speed of thought, and in our day and age, that makes it a luxury. As I walked, I thought about my boys. Gunnar's a senior next year, and like all families, we are anxious about what his last year of high school will be like. I thought of Gideon and what a fun age he is in right now, but also what an important age it is for forming friendships. He has missed his friends a lot during the lockdown. We want to try to be creative with how he can have some contact with his friends while still staying healthy and safe. These are hard arrangements to balance, and they seem to benefit from as much reflection as you can give them. A lot of balance. A lot of discussion among the adults on vacation centered on the shutdown, how we thought the balance should be struck between social distancing and staying engaged. I read the news stories about the resurgence of cases in many parts of the country, and it seems obvious that most officials in these places have had nothing like the time that we have had to reflect on those trade-offs. I do not pretend that we are smarter than they are. We simply have the luxury of time to think about these things and to discuss them. I have a love-hate relationship with Facebook. On the one hand, I am very proud of the motley crew I've assembled there amongst my Facebook friends. It really truly is a diverse group of people. They range from near ancient college professors who were mentors in college to ex-convicts, hedge fund managers, doctors, several lawyers, of course, actors, teachers, pastors, and jazz singers. Americans, both North and South, Africans, Europeans, Russians, Asians, Australians, even a Kiwi or two. There are some very far-right people, many of whom are either beloved family members or longtime friends from my youth, but some who are more recent acquaintances. There are a lot of lefties, but mostly there are people somewhere in between. Having so much difference provides me different perspectives and helps me to understand why those I disagree with have come to the conclusions that they have. Facebook genuinely keeps me in touch with some people in very real ways, in ways that do enrich my life. But it is not, by and large, a place of reflection. I've become very reluctant to repost or share posts because of how often these posts contain bad information. We do it on all sides, mostly innocently, but always without reflection. Maybe like these pop-ups you get in your emails that say things like, "Would you like to spell check this before you send?" Facebook should have a pop-up before we post that asks, "Have you reflected before making this post?" No one has ever become alienated or hurt by someone who has reflected too much on what they are saying. Jesus, in one of the most well-known episodes of the Gospels, spends 40 days fasting in the desert alone. Oddly, all we get from this is the famous temptations of Christ by Satan at the end of that 40 days. But what has he been up to those 40 days, besides not eating? Presumably, he's spent his time reflecting, studying scripture, and honing his philosophy that will become so world-altering. After all, we sometimes like to think of Jesus as having sprung fully developed from Mary's womb. Like Will Ferrell's character in the goofy comedy Talladega Nights, we assume the baby Jesus was already everything the grown-up Jesus was going to become, just waiting for Easter. This, of course, discounts his tremendous and unique journey, trials, triumphs, tribulations, friends, enemies, teachers, students, all of the many influences on his life, beyond just the scriptures to which he devoted thousands of hours of study. And it discounts the role of reflection. Reflection is the nursemaid of wisdom. Wisdom does not derive simply from a collection of facts and knowledge. No, it is far more hard won, which is why young people are often insulted by being told that it is beyond their grasp. The mere suggestion of that says more about the insulter's lack of wisdom than does about his audiences, but there is a grain of truth underlying that, and that wisdom takes time to develop, and it takes effort. Wisdom, I would say, is a combination of experience and reflection. And like a good wine, it deepens and improves over time. We are in desperately short supply of wisdom right now. Perhaps we always are, but that now seems to be a time in which we need it more. Also, possibly, I am simply at the point in my life, my 50th birthday fast approaching, that I can survey so many problems that we have struggled with my entire life and still cannot overcome. So my own place in the universe makes things appear more desperate than they truly are. And yet we do seem to be at an inflection point, or several, seemingly made more dire by this dearth of wisdom and the near absence of reflection. So my simple request this week to you is that while we all continue the hard work of examining our various privileges and what they afford us while costing others, take advantage of one privilege that carries no guilt, takes nothing away from anyone else, and that is sure to enrich your life and those around you. Take time to reflect on anything at all, really. And maybe I will see you this week out walking. I'll be the guy in the mask.
Myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you once say, word of God, speak. Pour down my grave, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness, word of God, speak. In the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, to hear your voice. Finding myself
at a loss for words. And the funny thing is, it's okay.
Will you please join me in our unison prayer? Dear God, we thank you for the privilege of quiet, of solitude, of awareness, of contemplation and reflection. We thank you for the beauty of your world, that we can walk amongst the forests and the rivers and the oceans and the mountains and be inspired. We thank you for providing so much for us, even in a time when many of us are suffering and are scared. We thank you for the potential that you have set upon our table and for the encouragement we need to embrace it. Amen. And now, let us return to the noise and the confusion of the world, knowing that we can find refuge somewhere quieter, determined to do so, and grateful for the privilege. Thank you all.